So in today's topology meeting, it's a great pleasure to have Barış Coşkunüzer from the University of Texas at Dallas. And we are going to hear about geometric approaches to persistent homology. So please take it away.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. So I'm going to talk about persistent homology. This is a great tool. Application of algebraic topology into data science, like 10, 15 years old. And in this last decade, it grew like market acceleration. And it is basically an approach to understand the shape of the data. And by understanding the shape of the data, I mean you want to get some well-defined, unique fingerprint of the data for the data forms which the usual statistical methods does not apply. The idea is the following. So for the different forms of data, you want to understand the topological patterns, and you want to see some shape features. And by looking at them, you want to get some unique fingerprints. So when I say this, I'm going to focus on three types of data, the usual application of topological data analysis. One of them is point clouds. This is very common. You can think of this point cloud something like this. Let's say you have 1,000 people. You have like you make a survey, and 10 questions: age, salary, weight, other questions, the education level, etc. You quantify them. You have 10 information for each person. And each person can be represented a unique point in the 10-dimensional space. Let's say you have 1,000 people. That can be represented with 1,000 points in 10-dimensional space. Now, usual statistical methods works very well here, but in high dimensions, and normalization problem in the between the axes. So this is a very difficult problem for statistical point of view, and the shape features is becoming very important, assuming our point class forms some sort of shape like this. So I can recognize some small circles here, large circles here, and assuming that these are uniquely identifying this point cloud, it will help me with my classification problem. Another very important application of the TDA is graphs and networks. When you look at a graph like this, usual statistical methods fails to make some classification. For example, you have some Twitter data, blockchain data, or Facebook data. It gives always a graph like this, connection between the users, etc. And you want to identify the types of users. And the usual statistical methods does not apply here. And what you do is you are looking at the neighbors of the users in the graph, and then similar shape represents similar users. That's the intuition, and you can use TDA for these problems. Another problem you can apply is the images, image classification, image computer vision. What you can do here is you have lots of pictures here. You want to identify the ones with the cat or dog or play, etc. How are you going to do that? And these all pictures represent some sort of shape, and can you recognize this shape by using topology? That's the question. TDA applies very well in this field. In the last 10 years, in many fields, finance, network analysis, material science, image recognition, and different fields, they have lots of papers on this. They have nice approaches here. And recently, there are ways to combine TDA tools with the deep learning to improve the performance of each other. And this is a very interesting subject too. So what is the idea here? We want to find topological patterns hidden in the data. So what do I mean by that? So when I say topological patterns, I want to measure them somehow. And the tool I'm going to use is homology, a topological invariant, one of the nicest ones, which can be applied in any dimension. So I assume most are familiar with the definition of homology, but I'm going to go over this again. So when I say zero-dimensional topological features, I mean the number of components. So in the first picture, I see six components. I don't see any loop here. I will say this set, this topological space, have rank six in zero-dimensional homology. And there is no hole here. There is no loop here. It's rank zero in one-dimensional homology. For this one, there is only one piece. So my zero homology is rank one. And I have three holes here. When I say hole, it's an unfilled circle. These are three circles. I'm going to say it's rank three. Let's look at the Brown simplicial complex here. It's also one piece. Zero-dimensional homology is rank one. But I see some circles here, holes, one, two, three, four, five, six holes here. It's one-dimensional homology is six. So I am counting the loops, the cavities, and these are going to be my topological features I want to count. For two dimension, you can look at this sphere, triangular sphere here. It's one piece again. When I see it, there are loops here, but they are all filled loops. They are not empty holes. So there is no one-dimensional feature here, but I have a two-dimensional feature. I assume this is not a tree ball, this is a sphere, empty sphere. I have a cavity inside. I'm going to count this as a two-dimensional topological feature. A two-dimensional homology of this guy is one. So you can continue like this. So these are the way to recognize some features in my data here. The intuition is similar shapes, similar topological patterns gives me similar classes. If the shapes are similar, then classes should be same or similar. That's the intuition. But the real question here, okay, I can recognize some shapes, but how can I formally summarize them? How can I formally decode them? So the tool for this is called persistent homology. Persistent homology delivers a nice topological summary of the data in the following form. It coarsely detects the well-defined way, the components, loops, cavities, along with their sizes. So let's look at this picture. So I see, of course, two-point class in the left and right. In here, I have some spread points. And if you look from very far, it will look like a two circles next to each other. One of them is a large circle, one of them is a small circle, but it's a vague circle. In this right one, you see that this is a very dense point set, a point cloud. The points are closer to each other, and it defines a very nice shape of a circle. As the points are very close and large circle here, I can recognize the distinction between these two guys. But question is, how can I formally interpret this as a mathematical way? I see this is different, very different from this guy. A large circle and very, very nice feature here because the points are very close. This is a vague circle, large circle, and small vague circle. How can I make a distinction here? The persistent homology works in the following way. There are two types, basically, two basic constructions. Either you give me a topological space at the beginning, or you give me a point cloud, and I am going to construct my topological space in a natural way. And then I'm going to extract a persistent diagram, which is the outcome here. So I am going to explain this black box in the following example. In here, in the left, I have a point cloud. So the intuition is when I look at from far away, it will give me a topological pattern like a circle here, etc. And I want to formally define them. So looking from far away basically corresponds to cannot distinguish two very close points. And you can look at this following idea. So for each point, you start with making some round disk around them. At this, they say 0.1 level, 0.2 level, and you increase your radius. At the 0.1 level, so at the zero level, I have 15 components here. When I make my radius 0.1, let's say they are not intersection, but let's say at 0.2, there are some intersections. At 0.3, there are more intersections, etc. Let's say this is my 0.5 level, this guy. And you can see that how many components do I have? One, two, these five guys are merged to each other, three, four, and all of these guys are five. So I started at zero level. There is no merging here. At 0.1 level, some of them merge, five of them merge, means five of the balls intersect each other, two components become one. So I lost, I decreased my component size 15 to 10 here at this level. And then I'll continue increase my radiuses, and some more merging happens. And at 0.5 level, exactly this stage, I have only five components left here. I start at zero. At 0.5 level, I have only five components left. I am just keeping track of this radius increase and then change in my topology. And after a time, like 0.8 level, all of them merge. I have only one component. This long barcode in the bottom represents red barcode, represents the number of components here. It will survive forever because number of component is at least one here. Now let's look at the blue guys. Let's say it, at 0.8 level, my first circle merged. This is an unfilled circle here. And then I see that this is a one-dimensional topological which I'm recording it. It was born here. And then just little later, this second loop merged. And then I'm going to record it too. So 0.8 level, radius 0.8 level, this first circle merge. At level one, this circle merge. And then you continue here at 1.3 level, you see that when you increase your radius, this small circle get filled. I said I lost this topological property. This is the dead time for the second guy. This is the birth time is one. This is a 1.5 level. This guy is dead, but this guy is still survives. I'm gonna call this guy a persistent guy. It doesn't die. It does want to survive. And finally, after some large radius, everything gets merged, and I will get these barcodes here. So for this guy, this red guy represents zero-dimensional persistent barcode. Give me a second. And the blue guy represents one-dimensional persistent barcode. This is exactly the output I want to get from this point cloud. And you can also equivalently represent the same thing as a diagram like this. What do I mean by that? Every barcode has an initial point. I call it birth time. And the end point, which is a dead time of my topological feature. And these are two points. So x-axis represents birth time. Y-axis represents dead time. Every barcode can be uniquely represented by points here. For example, this large circle, large barcode, blue barcode, let's say it starts at 1 and in 2.5. Let's say it starts with 0.8 and ends in 2.5. 0.8 to 2.5, it can be represented with this point. The small barcode here, let's say it starts at 1 and in 1.5, it is here. You can see that y is always greater than x here because that always comes from, comes later from the, later than the birth here. This is the persistence diagram. This is persistence barcode. They are the same thing, but we usually use persistence diagram. This is the unique topological fingerprint for the point cloud I have here. This is the point cloud setting. Or you can give me a topological space at the beginning, and I can filter this by using a Morse function like that. Meaning, this is my topological space M. I am going to use sublevel filtration. And for sublevel filtration, what I do is the following. This is my Morse function. At the 0.1 level, give me a second. I forgot to add this guy up. I need to use this. Give me a second. So sublevel filtration means for each value of F, you just look at the guy. This annotation. Give me a second. Yeah. I should use blue is fine. Yeah. So look at this guy. Let's say this is one. When you have one, you have exactly, let's say M1 here. M1 represents F inverse negative infinity to one pre-image. Pre-image of 0, 1 here, for example. This is 0, this is 1. And at 2 level, you see, so you start at 0, you have one component here, right here. You increase your level, and up to here, you still have one component, but when you reach this level, let's say 1.8, you'll have two components now. You continue like that, you have still one, two component here, etc. But when you reach here, these two components merge. When I say this level, so these two components become one component here. When you reach here, you need to make a decision here. So one of the barcodes will die because there were two components. Now it will become one. This is called elder rule. Younger one lives longer. So the older one lives longer. So if it start earlier, I'm gonna favor this barcode and I'm gonna kill the younger guy. This will die first, and then this will continue forever. Then I'll continue here, one barcode and etc. There is no more guy here. So this is zero barcode. For the one, I start here. There is no loop here. And when I get to here, you can see that exactly at this point, I have a shape like anus here. There is a loop here. This is my first bird for a one-dimensional feature. I continue here. It is still an anus. But when you got to here, it will become a punctured torus, something like this. You have a second topological feature was born here. You continue here, you have another bird, but it will die with this index to critical point. You just kept this off, and then it will die here. So this is the persistence barcode. Let me call this guy A. Let me call this guy B. A is here, it will live forever. Give me a second. Up to here. And B is here. It was born here, exactly. It died here. So that's the point B here. For this guy, you can also indicate, this is your C, this is your D, this is your E. C, D, and E are the corresponding points in your persistence diagram. So the second one is coming from you define the topological space at the beginning, and then you are filtering with a function, a sublevel filtration, and you just exhaust this whole topological space with this filtration. And then you just keep track of the topological changes in this sequence of topological spaces. And then if you see a new component, you mark it down. If the components merge, you mark it down. You see a topological fingerprint. We call this persistent diagram. Okay, that's the basic idea for both cases. Let me go back to mouse. Give me a second.
Barış, can I ask you a general question?
Yes.
This last example, this is Morse theory. So how much of it was already known before all these persistent things came out?
Okay. This is exactly Morse theory if your function is well enough, but we usually work in discrete setting in like five, 6 years ago for the computation of persistent diagram. Exactly, they want to use this Morse theory ideas, index 1 points, index 2 points, index 3 points, etc. The question here is to generalize your smooth Morse theory to discrete setting is not easy. There are a couple of papers on that to simplify our persistent diagram computations, but they are not widely used because, again, it has their own technical problems. But this is exactly what we are doing in the continuous setting. It works very well. Mm-hmm. But you have a C2 function for a Morse function, and they want to generalize this to simplicial complexes. I'm going to come to that point in a minute. We are not using these continuous spaces. we are using simplicial complexes for the computation. That's why Morse theory is not very useful here.
What I mean is that Zeno, the older generation, thought about putting dots where the or bars for this change in homology. Like before the persistent barcodes and homology started, we thought about putting this kind of dots or bars, because this idea of like homology changing is known. And people didn't use that bars in the past in 70s, or just curious social question. Anybody use this kind of bars or dots on?
No. So since I am overly simplifying what I am trying to do, no one uses topological spaces in the person's homology. Okay. So this is overly simplified version of this. You don't see this kind of spaces at all.
Okay, thank
you. So, but the real question is, how do you get the, so if I give you a graph, how do you get a barcode? Because your topological space will be a graph now. If I give you some point cloud, how do you get to this topological space first and then use these barcodes? But this is another technique which is used in the graph for graphs and images, but usually you don't get a nice space like this. This idea, Morse idea, is old, but you are converting the discrete setting in an interpretable way. That's the problem.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now how do we use this persistence diagram in the applications? So the similar persistence diagrams should represent similar shapes, similar classes. That's the intuition we have. And by using that intuition, we want to make some classification. So brain tumors, for example, you can either use the point cloud data coming from MRI data, and then you can say some tumor patients have similar persistence diagrams, and then you can look at this MRI data as a point cloud, or you can look at these pictures, tumor pictures, and then you can use a second type of persistence diagrams. I'm going to explain how do you get this in a minute in the image classification. But here, let me point out that persistence diagram by itself is not a good output for statistics. Usually people take the persistence diagrams because they are just pairs of points. How am I going to use them? I can take the average of these persistence diagrams. I can take the, I can't use this for clustering, etc. It's not a very useful output. People usually use some vectorization of these outputs, like Betty curves here. So Betty curves means how many live topological feature you have at a given threshold. You have these barcodes, and the barcodes will give you some Betty curves. In this tumor picture, for example, people just look at the normal patients and the tumor patients. They are looking at their persistence diagrams and then get these Betty curves. And that they will give you very different beta zero and beta one curves. Beta zero is a zero dimensional live features, and beta one represents a one dimensional live, just number of loops here. How do you get this from a picture? Is this picture, this question? If I give you a picture like this, you see the shape 8. So let's say this is 20 by 20 pixel. And what you do is the following. 0 is white, 256 is black, and you just get a function from 20 by 20 pixels, so that you have this two-dimensional picture. And if you look at this, in this picture, what you really have is, you have, give me a sec, use black now, you have 20 by 20, so you have 20 by 20 domain, and you have some sort of image, like your multivariable calculus course. That's a two-dimensional. So each pixel represents as a value. So it's a topological space like this. You are using the darkness. This is the darkness of the pixel here. It's the function you have. and then you start filtering this guy, and you get from starting from bottom to top, you'll get some filtration exactly like this. Let me give you the picture. So this picture represents this. So this is another application of personal type in a completely different field. I give you this picture. So here, like dark colors are at the bottom, white colors at the top, or super level filtration. So when you go to the black level, your filtering threshold is low, you only have these guys. When you go to red level, you have these guys. This is the topological features you have. And when you go to yellow level, you have these guys. Finally, you have these pictures. When you look at the changes, number of components, number of loops here, it will give you some unique features about this guy. That's the way we use this TDA in classification problems. Another application is the graphs. In the graph cases, many statistical methods fail because you only have, for a given graph, for a given node, you have the degree of the node, etc., how many edges it's going. But statistical methods are completely failing here to recognize the shapes in the graph. For example, you wanna classify the nodes here. So you have Twitter, let's say, data. It's a graph for your users here. And you say similar users have similar neighborhoods with these guys. And what you do is you are taking like three neighborhood or four neighborhood of each users, and you use some techniques to build the topological spaces for each graph here. And then you just check the similarities between the neighbors of each users, and TDA is very successful to recognize them. Also, you can do this protein classification. Meaning, I give you a class of proteins, and then you say like five class here. Can you detect the class of the protein by looking at the persistence diagrams of each graph, just like before we have? So these are some applications of TDA in different contexts. Now, today I'm going to talk about a meaning of the persistence. So when we say persistence, we mean the how long is my barcode. And the barcode's length supposed to give us the dominant shapes, the important shapes in my data, and the real features in the data, long barcodes. And the main intuition here is long barcodes, the barcode length represents the size of the homology class. So I want to understand this assumption by using geometric tools. And the main idea is the following. Let me define the question first, and then I'll give you some approaches. If you give me a point cloud, so for homology computations, I am not going to look at the spaces. I am going to go to a much simpler space with the same information. This is called Viatris-Ribbs complexes. So I give you this point cloud, and then this is radius 0. This is the points here. Radius 1, I have this space. Radius 2, I still have the same space. Radius 3, I see some intersections. Now it changed, number of components, etc. And I am going to induce a simplicial complex from this blue topological space. And it will be homotopy equivalent. This is called the nerve theorem. This is called Viatris-Ribbs complex. What I do is the following. If two balls, two disks intersect, I am going to add an edge between them. I don't see any intersection here. I see intersection here. So the topological type, the homotopy type of this whole blue space, the union of this three balls, is the same with this simplicial complex. This is one component here. I have a loop here. You can see I have a loop in the blue space too, etc. So this simplicial complex is much easier to work. When I go to radius 4, this time, three disks are intersecting each other. I get a triangle. When I see a triangle, I am adding a two simplex here. I am going to fill this up. If I see a tetrahedron, means a four vertices pairwise connected to each other, then I'm going to add a tetrahedron inside them to fill it. That gives me a simplicial complex, goes like this. and then my computations in this simplicial complex will be much easier because my homology computations will just become a linear algebra. In the continuous space, that's a very hard problem. In the simplicial complex setting, it's a very easy problem because it's just a linear algebra. So boundary maps, remember, if you know the homology, boundary maps becomes just the matrices here, and then the kernels, etc., will give me the homology here. Now, what is the persistence diagram in this setting? This is epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3. This is the thresholds, and this delta epsilon 1 x, delta epsilon 2 x are the simplicial complexes I get here. If a topological feature borns in one of these steps, I'm going to mark its birth time as bi. I say my topological feature sigma was born at bi. And then later it's get filled, let's say, at epsilon 5. I'm going to say its state time is epsilon 5. Epsilon 1 to epsilon 5, this is my topological feature's lifespan. It was born at epsilon 2. It died at epsilon 5. This is how I'm going to mark every topological feature was born and die in this sequence. And so I'm going to say sigma I was born in delta bi and sigma I get filled in delta bi. The length of the barcode is called the persistence or the lifespan of the homology class, just like this picture. Look at this large blue curve. It was born here, it died here. The length of the barcode supposed to represent its persistence because you have a loop and you are thickening it, and the first time it gets filled is exactly represents its lifespan. How long is my barcode is? Long barcodes, long lifespans represents essential topological features in my point cloud, and small ones called topological noise. Means it just pops up and then gets filled in. These are topological noises. They are non-essential. So small barcodes are non-essential features. Long barcodes are the essential features. And the assumption here is long barcodes represents the size of the topological feature here. The length of the barcode somehow should reflect the size of the topological feature I have here. That's the intuition. And now, in the remaining part, I want to understand this assumption. How does the length of the barcode represent the size of the homology class? So my setup will be very simple to understand this question. I'll come back to this question in a minute, but let me describe my setup first. So I'm going to take the simplest setup, and I'm going to explain why. So when I choose my point cloud, I'm going to induce this point cloud from a graph. You give me any graph, my point cloud will be the vertices of this graph. So my point cloud is this. And I'm going to define the distances, this is the crucial part, as the distances of these points to each other in the graph. This point has distance 1 to this point. This point has distance 2 to this point because I can go from with two edges here. This point and this point has distance 3 because 1, 2, 3. So this point's distance to this point is just 3. I will set up this setting at the beginning. Points and the pairwise distances are defined from the graph. So why am I doing that? Because I want to focus on the persistence question, the barcodes. And when I want to focus on that, the space I have, remember this space. So this space is hard to grasp, this blue guys. And I want to focus on, so when the thresholds are changing, like not like this, the pairwise distances of points are changing continuously or not discretely, but very irregular way. And I will have a very irregular barcode and I won't understand my question well. So that's why I choose my setting in this way so that every distances are changing in the integers. When you have that, we have this following Viatori strip sequence. This is my point cloud at the zero level. Radius zero is this. Radius one means add an edge between every pair of points whose distance to each other is one. This is exactly my graph here. But in here, you have a triangle. If you have a triangle, you are going to fill it with a two simplex. In the two level, you have, now you are adding an edge between every pair of points whose distance to each other is two. The red guys comes to the scene. Red edges represents the vertices whose distance to each other is two. And you have this graph. And when you take the clip complex of it, meanings when you add the when you fill the triangles, when you fill the tetrahedrons, you'll get your simplicial complex. And finally, in here, since the farthest two points are distance have distance three, every edge is here. Every possible edge in this graph is here. I have seven vertices. That gives me a six-dimensional simplex because every edge is here. So when you get to the diameter, you get everything filled up because every possible edge is there. You only have one simplicial complex, which is contractible. Every topological feature has that here. Now, let me describe you. This looks like a very restrictive setting, but it's not because of the following reason. If you give me any continuous space with any metric and ask the same question for the persistence diagram, what you can do, you can go to this continuous setting and you can take a very fine triangulation of this. Let's say you have a surface, you have a three manifold, you have any n-dimensional simplicial complex continuous space. You take a very fine triangulation. When you take a very fine triangulation, you get a graph.
And when you use... Sorry, Barış, I have a question. I missed something, I think. In the beginning, did you start with a graph together with a distance function?
Yeah, the graph...
Did you just start with a graph?
I start with the graph.
No,
but this graph is giving me the distance function. Oh, my point cloud is this.
Sorry, you didn't start with a point cloud, but you started with a graph.
No. Okay. You give me the graph.
Okay.
I start with a point cloud. I have seven points. That's it. But the distances are induced by the graph.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. So I am definitely staying in the finite metric space.
Mm-hmm.
Contours metric space, Vitruvius Ripps complex, immediately because infinite dimensional, it's very hard to work with. But I want to start with a finite set of points, but the distances are coming from the graph. And when you have this very fine triangulation of your continuous space, they are very close to each other in Gromov-Hausdorff sense. And we have a stability result for persistence diagrams. If two spaces are close to each other in Gromov-Hausdorff metric, their persistence diagrams are very close. So take any continuous space, take very fine triangulation, you switch to this setting, and then make your computations here, go back to the other setting, you'll see the similar persistence diagram. So you can converge, you can make an approximation to any continuous setting with this setting, so this is not very restrictive. So the question was, does the length of the barcode indeed represent the size of the homology class? That was the intuition. In this talk, we are going to make this more precise with the geometric topology ideas. So you give me the barcode. And let's say this is my persistence diagram. And it turns out in one dimension, this is exactly right. So let's say you have a graph and your click complex have like M loops here. And the persistence diagram will exactly be every word time is one. And every dead time is 1/3 of the length of this shortest basis. So the idea is, if you give me M loops in your original topological space, when you use the persistence homology ideas and take the shortest basis, and in the shortest basis, length over 3 will be the persistence of the each loop here. So the length is representing exactly the persistence here, the length of the barcode. Let's look at this example. When I say going to the higher thresholds, you should have always this picture in your mind. So this is a very intuitive picture. You can see it here. when this guy is getting filled, exactly when I take the tickering of these balls, the first time it fit in is exactly my loop is getting you can tick in your loop in an abstract space, let's say, and the first time it gets filled in is exactly your persistence, lifespan of the barcode. When you look at this way, so you give a circle of length 12. This is the threshold 1. When you go to switch a threshold 2, now you are connecting every vertices with whose distance is 2. You get more simplicial complexity, but this gives me the shortest loop in the homology class of this loop. This is my shortest loop in delta 2. When you switch to delta 3, now you are connecting vertices distance 3. You got this, guys.
Sorry, in the second picture, why are we connecting the remaining pairs, like, say...
There are more, yes. I am looking at the shortest loop. Okay. This is a much larger simplicial complex. This represents the shortest loop in the homology class of the original one.
Okay, so there are more
edges. Of course, connect the other guys too. You have lots of triangles here. But okay, I am representing only the shortest loop. Here, you have lots of tetrahedrons here, you are right. But I am always focusing the shortest loop in this guy, which is this guy. Since it's length 4, I cannot cap this off. But when I reach the length 3, I am capping this off. Length 4 loop, I cannot cap off this here. But length 3, I am adding my triangles. So this length 3 is exactly key here. That's why I have this 1 over 3 in my persistence diagram here.
But there's some notation here I don't understand. So delta 1, alpha, alpha square, what exactly they mean? Like alpha means... So
alpha 2 represents the shortest loop representing alpha in delta 2. Alpha 3 is the shortest loop representing alpha in alpha sigma 3, delta 3. Alpha 4 is this guy, shortest loop in here, but it gets filled in because triangles are filled in here.
So you have a graph and discretize with the distances.
Yeah.
You get delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, where you add more edges when the distance is allowed to be bigger and bigger. And then you, in each of these space, you define a loop representing homology class later, I guess, and the shortest ones. But they are homologous to the longest one too. So in terms of homology, doesn't matter. But somehow you say alpha is homologous alpha k. Alpha k distance is s over k. So what does that mean exactly?
Okay. The length of this is 4 now in this homology class.
Okay.
So this is a simplicial complex. Every edge has length 1. Now, it was 12 here, now it is 4 here. When it reached the 3 in my simplicial complex, I am capping this off.
Okay, I see.
But this is not the important part. This is already done in a continuous case already. I am just giving you an example. The important part is higher dimension. So this was done for K complexes in Gasparovich and Wang in 2018. And last year for Vector Sims complexes by Rick. And what they did is, the length of the barcodes exactly 1 over 3 times the length of the shortest representative of the loop. So persistence is indeed the size, the length of the homology class in dimension 1.
I'm sorry. So persistent is the size?
The length of the barcode.
So PD1G is defined as these barcodes, set of barcodes.
Yes.
And you're saying barcodes distance is the
barcode length.
Li over 3. Length is Li over 3. But Li is the length of these loops.
Yes.
When you choose these loops as the shortest ones in the growing sequence. but they change by delta. So you take it only in delta one. So alpha I's lives in the delta.
This is not the important part, Ergun. This is already done. I don't want to talk about this picture.
Okay.
Just to give you a glimpse of what I want to say.
Okay. So you're relating geometry to
yeah, the length of the barcodes representing the 1/3 of the shortest loop in the homology class. Okay. In dimension one, we have this picture. Okay. But the real question is, because this was already known, the real contribution we have is higher dimensions. So if I have the higher, look at this picture, 1/2 something represents this something times 3 length loop. Can you say the same thing in dimension 2? That all the birth times is less than 2, just like here. The answer is no. And we have lots of counter examples, very old counter examples. If you have a loop, if your graph is a circle of length k, then you have lots of second homology created in here with the later birth times. So the birth times can be very, very late for second homology. The real question here is, in this picture, length represents the length of the barcode, the persistence, the lifespan of the barcode. If my barcode is 1/5, I know that it represents a circle of radius 15, the circle of length 15. Can you say the same thing for second homology? So let's make a very wild assumption. When I say area of the homology class, in here, I choose the length of the number of edges it creates. In here, second homology, number of triangles it contains in my simplicial complex. And the idea here is the area, does the area indeed represents the length of the barcode? The answer is no, again. Look at this picture. In the left one, we have a square prism of base length 1. And let's say its length is billion. Very long thin box. Very long. And the area is 8 billion here. And let's look at the lifespan. When you're taking this up, in this third time, it will die no matter what. Because when you get, so in this dimension, you are filling this up. The area is 8 billion, but the lifespan is 3. So area for this shape is definitely not representative. You can have a very short lifespan with a very large area here for this guy, two-dimensional guy. But in this picture, let's say the edge length is k. The area is 4k square, and the lifespan here is 2k over 3. This fits this description. For this shape, I have something like this. For this shape, it completely fails. What is the difference between these two guys? So that's the question today. How can I differentiate them? How can I get an estimate like this? And this estimate is wrong totally because of this example. So how am I going to use this? So we understand that area is not capturing the lifespan information, but we can still get an upper bound with this. You give me any topological feature with birth time is b sigma and death time is d sigma, then the length of the barcode is exactly d sigma minus b sigma. So we showed that the area of the smallest representative this homology class square root is upper bounding this lifespan. It's not representative at all because of the thin long box, but it still gives me an upper bound. How can I show this? This is an idea from hyperbolic manifolds. So in hyperbolic manifolds, we always look at the manifold with thin parts and thick parts. We do the same in here. You give me a singular surface in my simplicial complex. It gives me my cavity, two-dimensional topological feature. This is a generator of a two homology, let's say, in this shape. You can see that in some parts, I see thin parts. In some part, it's a thick part. But how can I distinguish this in abstract sense? I know that this is the shortest representative of the second homology class, a cavity. Inside of this is a cavity. But in some part, it is thin. In some part, it is thick. The way we detect them is called, the notion called injectivity radius of a given point. What's an injectivity radius? In the surface, pick a point V here. So it's, look at its one neighborhood. Does it overlap with itself? No. Look at the two neighborhood. Does it overlap with itself? No. Continue. When you get to five neighborhood, let's say, it starts overlapping with itself. Then I will say the injectivity radius of this point is five. The first time it overlaps with itself in the five neighborhood, let's say, then the injectivity radius is five. And when it overlaps, I will have a circle like this. I'm going to call this bracelet of this point. The first time it overlaps with itself gives me a injectivity radius, and I will have this picture. And the idea here is, for thin pieces, injectivity radius is small. In the thick pieces, thick parts, injectivity radius is large. So I have this distinction. So you give me an M. In the thin parts, like this, my injectivity radius is gray regions, is less than M. In the other parts, my injectivity radius is greater than M. That's the idea. And I want to get an upper bound with the area. I'm going to make a very rough estimate. I'm going to choose my M less than the square root of area over 2. When you do this, you have this picture. This is the singular surface you give me as a generator of your homology class sigma. I am looking at, for this M, thin thick decomposition of this. I have this three thin pieces and a singular surface like this. These are very thin. And thin pieces supposed to die very quickly, and thick piece will survive longer than that. That was the intuition here. And it turns out, I separate these thin pieces and thick pieces. In thin pieces, in 2m time before this m, I am going to cap them off because the diameters of this circles, because of the definition, will have less than 2m. I can cap this off. The whole surface is union of these closed surfaces in a homology sense. When you add these guys up as chains, it will give me this. This will cancel each other. And I'm going to say that these thin surfaces will die very quickly, and thick surfaces will die later than that because of the following reason. In the thin surfaces, you can chop them off into small pieces with small diameter, and then they will die very quickly. But in the thick pieces, you have this picture. So in the thick pieces, I know that injectivity radius is greater than M. They are thick. And you can prove an isoperimetric inequality here. You can say that any R ball up to this injectivity radius must have area 2R square. The way I choose M, I can say that for any thick surface, I can cover with this thick surface with two balls. Two, because the total area is 4R square, for my 4M square. That's why I can cover the whole thick surfaces with these two balls. When you have this picture, you can fill the whole surface with these tetrahedrons, V1, W2, W3, V0, V1, W3, W4, V0, V1, W4, W5, V0. They will give me tetrahedrons, vertical tetrahedrons. When you close this up, then you can get your filled surface here, and you can finish the whole theorem here. That shows that the area gives you a square root of the area, gives you an upper bound for the persistence of a homology. The length of the barcode can be bounded by the area. But that's an upper bound, and that's a very bad upper bound. I know that because of the thin log banks. So this is not a good interpretation of the persistence, but it gives me an idea how to measure the persistence in the following way. The right notion to approach this, not the area, it's the width coming from minimal surfaces. So if you give me any homology class like this, like ellipsoid, we define sweep outs. Sweep outs are the following. So for W, take the one ball and look at its neighborhood. It's a singular surface, like singular circle like this. Two ball and two circle. The boundary of the two ball gives me a circle like this. Boundary of the three ball gives me a circle like this. In a way, you are looking at the circles whose distance to W is one, whose distance to W is two, whose distance to W is three, and go on like that. This red curves are the sweep out for W. Do the same for V here. Circle of distance one is this guy. Circle of distance two is this guy. Circle of distance three is this guy. This is a sweep out of your whole manifold from this direction. So what we do here is look at all the sweep outs of the whole manifold, let's say whole singular surface here, and do the following. So this is another way to look at this. Your function is distance function to the V0. You get a sweep out like this. And every V0 gives me a different direction to sweeping this out. And what we are doing here is we want to find the fittest look in which direction my manifold look the thinnest. That's the question. This is called width of the manifold. Means for every sweep out here, choose the largest guy. In this one, blue guy, this is the largest guy. In this one, this one is the largest guy. For every sweep out, choose the largest guy. And among all sweep outs, find the minimum of this largest guy. This will give me exactly here, for example, this is my width. This red guy will be the shortest maximum slice for each sweep out. I'm going to say my manifold looks fittest in that direction. If I slice it in this direction, this will give me the best look for my manifold. I call this the width of the manifold. This is an idea from the minimal surfaces, but it's also a very old idea in metric geometry to measure the size of a manifold. When you do this, we show that the length of the barcode, the persistence of the homology, the lifespan, is exactly bounded by the width plus one. So for each barcode in any, we will show that this is true for any dimension. In two dimensions, this is true because of the following picture. You give me the best look, means the smallest of the maximum slices in this picture. C4, for example, is my maximum slice. Let's say its diameter is M. Let's say its diameter is 10. So every other slice here has diameter less than 10, right? And look at this slabs here. This circle is less than 10, diameter less than 10. This circle is less than diameter 10. In the 10 time, everyone will be kept off because they will give you a nine dimensional simplex and then you can cap them off. You will have a collection of closed surfaces in 10 time. And every slab here has diameter at most 11, because this guy has diameter less than 10, this guy has less than diameter less than 10, and they have distance one in the vertical direction. In 11 time, the total diameter of the slabs, these closed surfaces, will be less than 11. That will give me k dimensional simplex. Why? Because if I have k plus one vertices here, every one of them has distance less than 11 from each other. So in 11 time, in 11 threshold, that will filled up. So every slab is filled up in this time. The whole manifold will be filled up. That was the basic idea. How much time do I have? Oh, over time. Let me finish with this. So you can generalize the same idea to any dimension. I gave you the proof in two dimension. But exactly the same idea works in any dimension. So the length of the barcode, the persistence of a homology class, always bounded by the width of the manifold, width of the homology class. We didn't generalize the area into higher dimension, that it becomes very technical when you go to singular surfaces. But since area is not a good indicator, we didn't bother to for show it for the higher class. So the bottom line is, the width is a good representative for the size of the homology class. Means, if you give me a barcode, the width of the homology class is somewhat reasonably close to my persistence here, but the area is not. Area can be very, very off. Okay, so I'll stop here. If someone asks me, I can talk to more about the interaction with the Bernoulli's fling radius, about the persistence diagrams, the lifespan, and the persistence relation with the Gromov's fling radius, if there's any questions. So I'll stop here since I am already over time. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice talk. So any questions for Barış Hoca?
Barış, I don't know if I followed the last part, but just to understand, so you're replacing the area measure as an upper bound with this slice
width.
And so does this work for discrete data that you get, or you need a surface to do this?
No, you give me any simplicial complex and you give me a homology class. Mm-hmm. When you say homology class in two dimension, it will definitely give me a singular surface in a simplicial complex. I'm always in a simplicial setting. And in this simplicial setting, you have a surface with a metric. Every edge has length one. It induces a metric here.
How do you see it as a surface? Like it has a distance and so on, but surfaces, you know, you have to have smoothness and so on.
No. When I say surface, it's a singular surface all the time.
Singular
surface means I have a two cycle. Uh-huh. In the homology class, I am just looking at the body of that.
I see. So
I have a metric on that by just declaring every edge has length one.
I see.
So and I have been trying to interpret the largeness of this simplicial cycle with the barcodes. I'm trying to relate the barcode's length with the some measure of geometric measure. It can be area, number of triangles in the singular surface, or the width here is another notion, which is better suiting for this question.
Better suiting sounds like it should be smaller, but I guess in high dimensions, you don't know the width is smaller than area.
That's the Gromov's fling radius question.
Okay, so what's that?
Gromov's fling radius is exactly this. You give me any manifold or any simplicial complex singular surface, etc. The Gromov's fling radius, you take your manifold and thicken it in some abstract space, just like the original picture. So first time it gets filled in these thickenings is the Gromov's fling radius. But this abstract space should be special so that, for example, this is cheating. You cannot cheat, for example. I give you a circle of radius 10, for example. That's the real picture, but this is also a circle of radius 10, right? So how am I going to see? In my abstract space, the extrinsic distance should not be less than intrinsic distance. That's the condition I have. So you cannot cheat, but in this abstract space, this is the right one, you look at the thickenings. First time, so this is your first thickening, second thickening, and third thickening. First time, it gets filled. So these are your thickenings here. Is the Gromov's fling radius of this circle. In any manifold, you can define this. You give me any manifold. In the abstract space, this is called Kolotovsky embedding. Berat gave a talk about this last week. So in these thickenings, first time it gets filled my homology class is Gromov's fling radius of this guy. Now, what I define is, this width idea is one width, codimension one sweep out. what I did is codimension one sweep out, and it's unison one with in metric geometry. But the conjecture here is there is a finer definition of width by using not codimensional one, but one-dimensional sweep outs. So if you know Seifert fiber spaces, you are filling the whole manifold with one-dimensional foliations, singular foliations. Now in here, look at this picture. This is codimension one. This is codimension one. And in higher dimensions, this is a very way off because, for example, you can have this picture. Let me show it to you. When you have this picture now, not thin long box, but something like a manifold like this. The width is very large. My width is very large, one width. But the when you have this guy, it will collapse in two time. The width is very large now, but it will collapse in one time or two time. This is like a pancake. When you have this, my width estimate is not good anymore. But the from Gromov's filling radius, the conjecture, this is a big conjecture in the metric geometry. K minus one width is the good indicator for the persistence here. So that's the higher dimensional version of this. Yeah. I hope it was not very technical. But so this is a big question in metric geometry. Uh-huh. One of the most, so the most filling radius idea come in early 80s. You want to measure the size of a manifold. I give you any manifold with a metric. So small sphere, large sphere, okay, these are defined, but how do you measure the size of a manifold? That was the question. Gromov's filling radius is one of them. So one of the ideas, how large is your manifold? In some nice abstract space, if you take the thickenings, first time it gets filled is one of the ideas to measure the size of a manifold. And this unison K minus one width is one of the conjectural lower bounds for that.
Okay, thank you very much. So any other questions for Barış Hoca? Okay, so maybe it's time to end the session. So let's give it a applause.
Thank you very much
for the great talk.
Okay.